Benson, Bardoli. Come with me.
It's less painful than the collar. Turn around. Captain, you will be practice target.
All lead in, sir. Come on, McCoy. You're taking a chance on not getting back home.
We'll get home. This won't take long.
40 minutes, we've got to go.
Shut up. I can save his life.
Enterprise to Captain Kirk.
Kirk here.
Condition red, condition red. Captain?
The music you just heard has got to be one of the all-time most reused music cues in all of Star Trek. 7 different episodes at least. And that doesn't count the original episode for which that score was written. Well, stay right there, and we'll take a good look again at more of Star Trek's finest music from composer Gerald Fried. Well, in my 2 previous videos, we explored Gerald Fried's music from Amok Time and Catspaw. This time, we'll look into Fried's 3rd and final contribution to Season 2, Friday's Child, which had its NBC premiere on December 1st, 1967. Friday's Child co-starred 2 well-known TV actors of the day, Tig Andrews, who portrayed the square but somehow cool police captain Adam Greer in the Mod Squad, and the incomparable Julie Newmar, perhaps the most beloved Catwoman from the Batman series. DC Fontana's script has the Enterprise orbiting Capella 4 to negotiate mineral rights, only to discover that a Klingon, the show never mentions his name, but it's crass, he's already arrived to bargain for their rocks. Jerry Fried's score prominently features brass and percussion, and conflict is immediately set as the prologue concludes with QM12, Capella 4. How many scenes in Season 2 closed with these few bars?
A Klingon!
Grant, no!
Well, it isn't long before the plot thickens with 2 events back to back. First, the Enterprise receives a distress signal from a supposed Federation vessel. Then, back on the planet's surface, the landing party realizes that they're in the middle of a power struggle as Ma'ab and his supporters set in motion a violent uprising against Aka'ar, the current and aging Tyr. Composer Fried must have loved this challenge, because he created a work in 3 parts. First is Scotty's sense of alarm as he slowly turns to the main screen. So part 1 of the cue, Distress Signal, is solo piano in octaves in the low register playing a pattern of diminished fifths. Now, I'm no student of 20th century tone row music, and probably some of you are, but let me just say, in the right situation, something like this really works to make you feel unsettled. Check it out.
I've lost it. It sounded like a distress signal from an Earth vessel.
And then there's a... All right, with tension now established on the bridge, a timpani roll is all it takes to propel us into some of the best-known action music of the series. Part two of this cue is fast-paced and fortissimo for the entire ensemble of clarinet, bassoon, piccolo, trumpet, horns and trombone, timpani, snare drum, and gong. I've been listening to this recording, apart from the video, again and again, and I'm astounded at the performance level of these LA-based studio musicians. Fried gives them 6 bars with staccato 16th note passages in a breakneck tempo of 145 beats a minute. These players would have to use a technique called double tonguing in order to produce what was on the page. It involves using first the tip of the tongue, think d, or t, to interrupt the airflow, followed by the middle or back of the tongue, think of g or k, for a second interruption, so d, g, d, g, d, like that. Well, it's not terribly difficult to do, but when you consider how many players are involved, what, maybe 18, 20 wind instruments, all playing this tight staccato part, and they just nail it every time. According to Juilliard music professor Andy Farber, these were the top studio players of the day and included LA Philharmonic principal clarinetist Kalman Block, flutist and UCLA professor Sheridan Stokes, and trombonist Milt Bernhard, who played with Stan Kenton and Frank Sinatra and others. Remember this? Okay, part three starts with a dramatic, dynamic change to a quiet, sustained undertone against solo piano. Again, but this time playing a true 12-tone motif.
Hang on. Communicators, weapons.
I have no quarrel with you, Captain. I wish merely to return to my vessel.
Now that 12-tone piano theme occurs again after the sonic-induced rock slide when the Klingon kills a Capellan and sneaks off with a phaser weapon?
Try to play that fast.
Well, this new 12-tone motif is essential to the rest of the episode. Recall the very opening of this video, that mashup of 7 episodes with the same music? All 7 were tracking the cue down the throat from Friday's Child, where Fried adapts that 12-tone piano theme to brass and winds. Let's see if you have the belly for it.
This is the USS Enterprise calling unidentified Klingon vessel. Come in. USS Enterprise calling Klingon vessel. Acknowledge, please.
I have it on the view screen now, sir. Still distant. Holding a position dead ahead, sir.
Drawing a line, daring us to step over it.
Still closing. The begins directly in our line of flight.
This is the commander of the USS Enterprise. Identify yourself and your intention. Acknowledge. Close out the frequency, Lieutenant.
Phaser banks are ready, sir.
And we'll go right down their throat if necessary. Let's see if they have the belly for it.
Well, Jerry Fried made a very interesting remark in his interview with Jeff Bond about a trick he learned from Mozart and Bach to keep the momentum going throughout everything he wrote. He cited, in all the good composers, there's rhythmic propulsion. In Bach's day, it was called continuo, that harpsichord that just played along in every bar as orchestra and vocalists painted melodies and counterpoint over it. A great example of rhythmic propulsion is in the climatic scene where Kirk and Spock deploy a weapon the Capellans never developed, the bow and arrow. Well, this is cue M61, simply called Arrows. I love how the downbeat chord in the brass just grabs you. It's a G suspended with a flat 9, and the piano doubles an ostinato pattern in the bassoons and basses, timpani and snare drum added to the propulsion, and that same 12-tone theme finds a new home in staccato brass and winds.
First, verify your story.
Is this what your sworn word means, Klingon?
Well, there's more to that cue, but I wanted to get to the finale of the drama, when Ma'ab spares Elian her life. After all, she had lied about killing the Enterprise landing party. But Ma'ab, in doing so, forfeits his life to the Klingon, thus allowing the newborn son of Aka'ar to become the new Tyr. Not a dishonorable choice. The next cue is called Forfeit, and it speaks of sacrifice and mortality, honor and finality.
Klingon!
Well, the Desilu music editors really deserve their own video recognition for their work on Star Trek. In at least two later episodes, music editor Jim Henriksen kept the Arrows/Forfeit suite together, and that's a great lead-in for a killer cue reel.
My compliments.
Thank you.
on this. Three to be... Oh.
Enterprise to Captain Kirk. Ready to beam up three.
That's where our duty lies.
Altitude 1,000 feet. Almost.
Take us out of orbit, Mr. Sulu. Ahead warp 5.
So amusing.
Now it's up to us.
The ball is...
down the street.
Well, June and July 1967 was a very busy time for Gerald Fried. He had to have his Catspaw score ready for a June 21st session. Then a little over 2 weeks later, July 7th, he was back on the scoring stage with Friday's Child, this music. And then less than 2 weeks later, July 19th, he was back again with his phenomenal score for Amok Time. Here is a man with music superpowers. When you factor in the complexity and sophistication of the music that he and other Trek composers produced in such a short time, it's no stretch to say Star Trek was blessed with the finest music of the day, and perhaps nothing since has topped it. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this series on Gerald Fried and his music trilogy for Season 2. I sure have. Next, I'll get into the wonderful music from composer George Duning for Metamorphosis and Return to Tomorrow. This will take some time.
Let it take time, lad.
So until then, trek long and prosper.